Check. All right, Graham, I don't know if you want to just flick to the first slide. Thanks very much. So good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us today. Just to introduce you to the speakers, I'm Hannah Leslie. I work in the design engineering team in the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland. And we really work with a range of companies with their product development journeys, including design development and the verification and validation activities that go alongside that. I personally work in the business development side of things, the front end side of things. So I do a lot of work in supporting companies in accessing funding for these development projects where necessary, and quite often signposting to other partners within our network where needed. I'm also joined by Graham Bisland, who is one of our senior research and development engineers in the team. I don't know if you want to just introduce yourself, Graham.
Hi, my name is Graham Bisland. I'm a design engineer with 16 years industry experience gained across different industries from construction, power, oil and gas, water treatment. For the last year, I've worked in National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, which is led by the University of Strathclyde. National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, as it's often referred as, or NMIS, as it's often referred, is a research and technology organisation supporting companies operating in many sectors important to Scotland, which Hannah will give an overview of in just a minute. For this session, I'm going to discuss risks, regulations, standards, and how these relate to product development and technology readiness levels, which we hope will be most useful to SMEs starting their product development journey. But hopefully there's some useful information for everyone. Hannah?
Cool. So just some housekeeping for the webinar. It's being recorded and will be made available afterwards on our YouTube channel. Your webcams and microphones are turned off during the session just to avoid any background noise, but please do feel free to join in the chat and ask any questions there. We will take some time at the end to do a bit of a Q&A and answer any questions that you might have. You can also engage with us on Twitter using the hashtag NMISInsights, and our handle is at NMIS_group, and our marketing team will be keeping an eye on that to keep us right. And finally, please do take some time to complete a survey that will be sent to you after the webinar. It really helps in the future in getting that feedback. So just before we get into the actual content of the webinar today, I'll just give you a brief overview of what the National Manufacturing Scotland's all about. So NMIS, the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, is a group of industry-led manufacturing research and development facilities. And the aim is that research, industry, and the public sector will be able to work together to transform skills, productivity, and innovation, ultimately with the goal of attracting investment and making Scotland a global leader in advanced manufacturing. In terms of what we actually aim to do, we're looking to reduce barriers to innovation. I imagine many of you will be familiar with these issues that you might come across when trying to innovate within your own sector or your own application in terms of access to resources, information, and things like that. And hopefully we as NMIS can help combat that. We aim to stimulate investment and increase manufacturing competitiveness for Scottish and UK companies. And really be a catalyst for job creation and strengthen supply chain links across multiple sectors throughout Scotland. We hope to inspire and attract new talent or new technology and look at current equipment and capabilities and really look at how we can help to transform the business needs within Scotland. And finally, working with manufacturing businesses of all sizes and in multiple sectors important to Scotland to really provide benefits across the country. NMIS is part of the One Scotland team. I won't read out all the partners you can see listed there, but we are operated by the University of Strathclyde and supported by a number of organisations and partners. And we've all got the same aim of increasing capability and competitiveness for Scotland. It's also supported by universities across Scotland, so it really is a countrywide initiative. In terms of how NMIS is set up, it's got two specialist centres, the Advanced Forming Research Centre, which a lot of you might be familiar with. It's the oldest centre that we've got, and the Lightweight Manufacturing Centre, which was opened just a couple of years ago. NMIS will also operate a number of core elements, the Manufacturing Skills Academy, which hosts a number of professional development courses, the Digital Factory, which is currently in development, and the Collaboration Hub, where companies across Scotland can come together. Importantly, though, NMIS is operating right now. We're open and available to support organisations today. So if you would like to get in touch or if you'd like to know more about NMIS or about the developments of the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, please feel free to email us. I'll be giving contact details at the end of this presentation, or you can visit our website and, as I say, catch us on Twitter. So that's all for me. I'll pass over to Graham, who'll get into the meat of the presentation just now.
Thanks, Anna. So let's look specifically at my team. This image shows you where the NMIS design engineering team expertise lies with respect to product development on the route to market acceptance. We perform these activities with clients or collaboration partners who are seeking to develop new products. We're not a design consultancy, but sometimes it will make sense to come to us instead of a consultancy. The most common reasons being to access different funding sources or to draw on specific manufacturer experience. But obviously every situation and product is different, so should be assessed on a case-by-case basis. It's worth particular note that we are network sponsors of Product Design Scotland, and as such, we'll signpost inquiries their way when it's not a natural or comfortable fit for us. We're not really greedy that way. Areas where we as a team are involved are product design and development, shown on the left here, which includes requirement capture, conceptual and prototype work, material selection, method of manufacture selection, cost modelling, to name but a few. This is bolstered by our other theme around market acceptance, which you can see on the right. This covers technology readiness level assessment, goals and objectives, setting, validation planning, design verification, liaising with test houses and third parties for validation trials and independent witnessing. Route to market acceptance is a phrase which was coined within the team. It's not to be confused with route to market, which deals with the more commercial and marketing aspect of bringing a product to a marketplace. Market acceptance is when your product ticks all the boxes of the end user and they're willing to accept it and purchase it. This generally entails compliance to specifications, standards, regulations, or anything else in the contract, which is what we are here to talk about today. When the team was established in 2019, market acceptance and product development were the two underpinning themes, but now as we move into our second year as a team, this has expanded to include mechanical design, CAD modelling, and tooling and fixture design. We've also listed here some of the achievements that the team has accomplished within this period. It's worth noting that about 80% of our inquiries as a team are from SMEs, and 70% of those are from SMEs with no funds, who can then be directed by us towards potential grants and funding sources. So, let's start at the beginning of the product development journey. There's a lot to consider, particularly if you're doing it from scratch or for the first time. You possibly won't know where to start, and there'll be lots of things you haven't yet considered or even thought to consider. To be blunt, it can be quite daunting, but you have to start somewhere, and the best place to start is by defining the requirements. Pew's Total Design provides a solid design framework and is the one we as a team tend to apply for product development, as it logically presents the design function as a systematic and disciplined process. The design core on the left here was introduced by Pew, and this is essentially just a simplified version of the product development process. On the right-hand side here, you see a more detailed view of the specification category of the design core. The requirements can be captured by category name. The category names are around the wheel here and under sections of your specification. So for instance, safety is one category and life and service is another. So for your specification, you would establish a specific requirement under each category. Let's say under life and service, you set a requirement for 25 year service life. Then you would go on to do this for all the categories. This gives you a robust requirement specification. It's worth noting here that it's important to set requirements that can be measured. So keeping with the previous example, as long as possible would not be a good life and service requirement, as it doesn't state a quantifiable target or what the market acceptance would be. Of course, the old IBM adage of garbage in, garbage out applies here. So to ensure a robust specification, you'll need to do market research and engage with the market or development partners in order to define sensible, achievable, and essential requirements. Even successful companies have history of projects failed due to poor requirements and management of them. If anyone can remember the Apple Newton, you're probably doing better than most. In my own experience as a significantly younger engineer, I once worked on a complicated linkage system for a power station. The goal was to close off some ductwork. The focus of many of the project requirements was on the elevated operating temperatures, which were around about 350 degrees C, and the concerns and impacts this would have on the system and its function. We'd neglected to set any requirements based on the cold ambient temperatures, even though the equipment was located outside. And unfortunately, the product was installed in 2009, in which, some of you may recall, Scotland had quite a heavy snowfall and temperatures dropped to around about minus 25 degrees C. This, unfortunately, caused shrinkage of the steelwork, which we'd failed to consider and resulted in the mechanical locking of the system and significant issues with the product. This then had to be resolved and strategies put in place to resolve it. This is a good example of how a poor or missed requirement can be detrimental to a project's success, and is generally, I think we all probably have lessons learned of similar issues we've had in projects in the past. So, requirement specification should be frozen, only to be revised periodically after project milestones or upon conscious change in direction. For example, a change in design pressure or design temperature would merit an update. If you're going to change a requirement, it's important to consider the impact that any changes can have on customers and the viability of your product. So everything really revolves around requirements, hence the importance of carefully defining these upfront. The specification you've created can essentially act as a checklist to utilize throughout the entire design process. As you progress from concept to validated product, you can check off and document your conformance to requirements. Once you've satisfied all the requirements or the specifications and validated the performance, then you've achieved a quality product or outcome. And assuming that you've done your market research, stakeholder engagement, and subsequent requirement capture right, then you're in the best place to maximize your chances for market acceptance. There are many risks associated with product development. For example, missing something when capturing requirements, a concept failing verification and requiring rework, a design being unmanufacturable, or cost being too high based on anticipated volumes. They're all commonly encountered in product development projects. To manage risks throughout the product development process, it's pertinent to be diligent in your approach. In this way, we would adopt and recommend a stage-gated design process, meaning at predetermined stages such as specification review, concept review, detailed design review, you would hold a review meeting to consider the work completed, the reviews which would then include input from key stakeholders or subject matter experts. Each meeting, would look to ensure the work to date conforms to requirements and is sufficient to proceed, or in some cases not. You should freeze the design after each successful review in order to ensure everyone is clear on the design intent and less aware of any resultant impact with respect to cost and lead time for changes made outside of this process. It's advisable to perform a failure mode and effect analysis, or one of its variants, at the conceptual phase, whereby you examine the function of each part and identify how it might fail. These can then be investigated for possible mitigations to eliminate the failure or controls to reduce these failures. As your concept evolves, you should update this document to ensure all components and functions are being considered and that you're executing the mitigations and controls you'd identified. Excuse me. At risk of saying the word until it loses all meaning, now to talk about known and unknown knowns. This philosophy was coined by ancient Greeks and has been referenced by NASA amongst many others. You can categorize risks into four types. The known ones are the easiest ones to deal with, as you have awareness of them and can proactively deal with them. Where things get a bit more dangerous pose significant threat to your project are the unknown risks, the ones you have no awareness of. These have to be handled reactively. Ideally, you want to convert as many risks as possible into known knowns. Many will start out as known unknowns, which will be maturing and developing in the course of the product development until they become de-risked known quantities or known knowns. An example of a known unknown might be a novel method of manufacture or material, which you wish to explore, develop. When you satisfy that it is usable and capable of meeting requirements, it's upgraded then to a known known. Unknown knowns are risks that could have been identified during the project planning stage, but were not, and go on to affect the project, such as my example earlier with the cold weather. These usually result from poor communication, for example, something which went wrong in a previous project but wasn't shared in a robust lessons learned and is now happening again. And you'll find this is probably one of the more frustrating ones because it's things that could have been avoided. Unknown unknowns are true surprises. Things you've never dreamt of happening. For example, I worked on a valve qualification. The product was well established, had done testing in the past, but in this instance, the client wanted witness for the testing. The product sailed through the testing up to the disassembly and inspection, at which point it couldn't be disassembled. Weeks of product testing came to a screeching halt because of an issue in the test setup, which identified a fundamental design fault. There was no way to plan for this, but it happened. This meant retesting from the start again, to the detriment of the customer and my blood pressure. Bearing in mind that nobody knows everything, so have the engagement with the right people, the right time. It's vital to your success in having a timely and cost-effective product development. So, it's impossible to know all regulations and standards. If you look at the IHS website, they have about 460 different technical societies producing standard and specifications. Consequently, it's not practical to go into any real depth during a brief presentation. So I hope to provide a bit of awareness of the subject area and leave you with some food for thought. This graphic outlines the order of precedence for requirements. At the top, we have mandatory laws and regulations, which are compulsory and vary by jurisdiction. During the requirement capture phase of the project, you consciously choose target markets which will influence the laws and regulations which apply. Be aware that these will vary according to geography. Also, these may have impact on your design, and as such, you may want to have some awareness of these as they can impact your design choices. I worked on a validation for an existing product for water treatment in the USA, which was a new market. Unfortunately, the NSF standards that the market demanded were more onerous, or at least different from those of Europe. And as such, we ended up doubling our already qualified European product range to accommodate the design changes for qualification within the US market, which in hindsight could have been avoided with some foresight during the initial product development and identification of not only the current, but potential future markets. So back to the chart. Laws are set by national lawmakers with the purpose of promoting safety and environmental protections. These are, of course, mandatory. Regulations generally override standards. Regulations are rules set by the public or government bodies to influence market activity and maximize welfare. Directives are similar to regulations, but lay out goals rather than prescriptive rules. However, you achieve these goals is up to you. Similarly to laws, regulations and directives vary according to jurisdiction. Examples of directives are the 21 EU directives which trigger the need for CE marking, such as the Pressure Equipment Directive or Low Voltage Directive. At this point, it's worth remembering contract law. Whilst the standard or specification itself might not be mandatory, the contract you may have with your client can make it a mandatory legal requirement. So be sure to triple check the references in any client specifications or orders you may have. A standard is any specification or physical characteristic, configuration, material, performance, etc., the application of which is recognised as necessary for the repeatability and interchangeability, for example, common interfaces or fasteners. Standards take a number of forms, including but not limited to industry, national and international standards. These can generally be viewed as best practice and are not generally compulsory. However, in some jurisdictions, national standards are mandatory. A point worth highlighting is it's difficult to demonstrate due diligence has been followed in the event of an accident if best practices, as portrayed within a standard, has knowingly been ignored. So ignore standards at your own risk. On the bottom tier, we would have specifications. These can be in the form of company specifications, general requirements, or project specifications, which document specific requirements for a given project. There's another level not shown here, which covers in-house procedures at an organizational level. These exist to create robust, reliable, and repeatable processes to enable organizations to follow best practices, comply with industry standards, and build upon these with additional restrictions and requirements for the betterment of the product. So let's take a minute to consider some tips for finding and obtaining standards. Once you know the market and industries that you're targeting, there are a number of international bodies and online resources to allow you to search and access these, or unfortunately, in most cases, purchase access to standards. I've listed a few here, but there are many more, including IHS, which I mentioned earlier. It's worth noting that it may be beneficial to shop around for standards. The same standards can be found on different sites for different prices, but I would advise always looking at the standards homepage as well. By that, I mean, if you're looking at BS standards, go to the BSI site. It's worth doing this because you'll be able to see the status of the standard. Is it the latest? Is it under review? If it's been superseded, what is the latest standard? These details sometimes aren't as well presented or updated as quickly on third-party sites. While talking about saving money, I'd also advise checking as much information on a standard as you can before you purchase it. Generally, a scope or possibly a contents page may be available for preview before you buy a standard. This can often let you establish if the standard will contain the pertinent information in it for you. A lot of standards are general or introductory standards or broken down into parts. You want to make sure you're buying the right part or buying the right information that you want. In terms of finding standards, all the sites will allow you to search using keywords and filters. But you may wish to consider looking for International Classification Standards or ICS codes. These codes provide a way of drilling down to select a group of standards within a field. It also avoids some of the issues you may encounter with things like American English spelling of words. So for instance, an example here, the 11 denotes the field is healthcare and technology. The 40 denotes that it's medical equipment, and the 70 denotes that it's ophthalmic information that you're looking for. So if I'm looking for information on glasses, I'd be drilling down using this code. It would provide me with a small list, which I could then review. So before we take a look any further into risks and standards, let's have a look at technology readiness levels, or TRL. Excuse me. And we can then have a look and see how these relate to risk regulation standards in the product development process. TRL scale was initially developed by NASA to support the planning of space technologies in the 70s and 80s. Since then, it's become more widely adopted across many industries. Understanding the TRL scale and where you are in developing your product is useful in terms of understanding risks and communicating the maturity of your product's development with investors and grant authorities. Putting it simply, if product development and technology qualification is the road, then TRLs are the road signs. It's worth noting that variations in the initial TRL scale has been developed for different industries, and a number of different standards exist with their own TRL scales and guidance in using them. We're going to use a 9-level scale today, which we use within the design engineering team. Although there's a lot of commonality between this and other scales, you can kind of see here, for instance, we have the 9-level scale and then a 7-level scale, such as that seen in API 17N. By comparing the two, you can see that the TRL 1 in the 7-level scale is a TRL 0, and TRLs 3 and 4 in the 9-level scale becomes a TRL 2 in the 7-level scale. This sort of comparison is easily done through bridging documentation, and you may look at bridging documentation as a means of communicating TRL levels with other people, stakeholders in your project who may be more familiar with a different scale. So in this graphic, we can see the relationship between product development and the TRL scale. It's a pretty generalized view, and it can differ depending on the structure of your product development. But this is one that's more akin to what we would typically see in the design engineering team. You probably notice that unfortunately the TRL scale doesn't fit nicely with the design development process stages. Some TRL levels are stretched across multiple stages, and some stages have multiple TRLs within them. This doesn't really impact either the scale or the process, but it's worth understanding. So, for instance, because you've completed preliminary design, it doesn't necessarily mean that you've completed TRL 4. So it's important to consider each separately, but appreciate the impact that product development has on TRL. So here we have on the top half of the page here, the ISO 16290, which is the European Space Agency TRL scale. I'm going to be pulling up the definitions as they've stated them. And on the bottom half, I'm going to try to interpret these into something that's a bit more meaningful for all of us. So for a TRL 1, the ISO standard dictates it as a basic principle observed and reported. Put simply, what this means is that you have a market idea. You've identified a market opportunity, or you were looking to adapt research for market. For a TRL 2, the ISO standard says it's technology concept and or application formulated. What this means is that you've developed concept or your concept or concepts, and you've defined your requirements within a document. For a TRL 3, the ISO standard would state analytical and experimental critical function and or characteristic proof of concept. What the key part here is it's proof of concept. So here you'll have chosen a selected concept and demonstrated that it's verifiable and usable to go ahead with further development. This is very much the simulation space, so this might be FEA or calculations. You may do some small scale testing, but that's slightly less common. For a TRL 4, ISO dictates it as a component and or breadboard functional verification in a laboratory environment. So this is functional testing of a representative model. By representative model, I mean this may be an aspect of your design or a small component within it, not the overall thing, although it could potentially be, but it's not as common at this level. This, at this point in TRL4, would also exclude environmental influences. By that, I mean you're not looking at impacts of things like corrosion or vibration that would be in the natural environment where your product would be installed. For a TRL5, the ISO dictates it as a component and or breadboard critical functional verification in a relevant environment. So this means testing of a representative model, including environmental influences. So this is really taking what you've done in TRL4 and proving that these functions are not impeded by the environmental influences, like we said. For a TRL6, it's model demonstrating the critical function of the element in a relevant environment. Some of these are getting a bit more obtuse, but this is really just meaning it's the product prototype. So now you have a prototype of your product, so more full scale, and it's tested in the relevant environment. So you're still in a test house testing it, and you're considering environmental impacts on the function, but you're now looking at things in a larger scale. TRL7, model demonstrating the element performance in a relevant environment. So again, this is the product prototype you're using, but this time you're looking to demonstrate its operation in more of the field or operational environment. TRL8, so now we have actual system completed and accepted for mission operation. So they're essentially saying here that your product is complete and ready for use, and you have the evidence in place up to this stage to allow it to go forward. Unfortunately, even though we're saying ready for use, you have not quite finished with your TRL scale. You have TRL9, which is the actual system proven through successful mission operation. So what you're saying is that you have installed your product somewhere, it's operating, and it's demonstrated its full functionality in the field under normal operating conditions. If there's a tip I could give, it's generally don't be scared of the TRL scale or the level you're at in it. If you have a TRL9 product and you want to apply it in a different environment or industry, then the product is taken back to a TRL2. Understandably, this can be disheartening, but what's important to bear in mind is that the route back up the TRL scale should now be significantly easier, as a lot of the evidence that's been generated can be reused to escalate up the scale again. Looking at it from the right level will be key to ensure that you aren't missing any new challenges and any changes that you need to implement into your design or into your product to resolve any potential risks. So let's now look at the TRL scale and its relationship with risk. As you can see in the graphic, the product development process here, as the product development progresses and the product matures along the TRL scale, the technical risk should decrease until you reach the TRL9 level, at which point the technical risk should be at a level which is acceptable. By this, I mean that the level set by you or by standards based on the criticality of your product. This criticality should consider the severity of damage to people or the surrounding environment due to a potential failure of your product. Also, another factor which could impact this would be the potential means or easy ease of access for intervention to resolve any potential failures. There are a couple of things to note here. This isn't a straight line I've drawn. That's intentional. My hand isn't that shaky. There will be setbacks that raise the risk, such as potentially testing failure. These sort of things can obviously cause the risk to rise again. And there will also be certain activities which have a higher impact on the risk. So for instance, concept generation will be less impactful on the risk than finite element analysis or validation testing to a standard. So let's now have a quick look at the role standards have in terms of product development and see where that lies against the TRL scale. So for product definition, you'll be identifying relevant regulations and standards that will impact your product, letting you understand the product requirements and any industry-driven validation requirements. For conceptualization, you'll be constructing a technical risk analysis to understand where the risks to the success of your product lie, and then building a verification plan around this. You'll also be looking at the validation needs and checking that your concept and technical risks don't introduce any further validation requirements now that you understand how your product's going to start to look. You can see if there are any standards you may have missed relating to particular aspects of your design at this point. For preliminary design, you'll be using standards to look at material properties and conduct your verification, calculations, and analysis. You'll be using CAD and models to confirm form and fit, and again, you'll be referring to standards to select components, fits, and potentially common components such as fasteners. For detailed design, you'll be conducting further verification activities, but also producing manufacturing drawings to require drawing standards, either selected by you or by your client. And thus, you'll be able to communicate with suppliers who will understand these standards also. For validation, you'll be testing a prototype of your product against a test procedure, which will utilise standards for safe working practices, as well as meeting any standard requirements for test methods. Many industries have very prescriptive testing steps, which are stipulated within standards. And finally, you'll be conducting manufacturing activities, ensuring that your production route meets quality standards, that the finished product meets the requirements, and the measures and processes are in place to ensure repeatability can be achieved. To summarise, some key takeaway points. Nailing down the requirements as robustly as possible is essential. It's the foundations for your project. You can change them, but any changes after design freezes will likely lead to rework, which adds costs and delay to your project. Be diligent. You don't know what you don't know, so be sure to be robust in your market research. Don't be afraid to ask questions. And on that note, don't work in isolation. Through your research, it's likely you'll encounter experts and or potential development or supply chain partners. Work with them. They want you to have success too, as you're a potential customer or future supplier. There are lots of tools that you can utilize in your product development journey. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. Templates exist for FMEAs, FMECAs, product design specifications, to name a few. And NMIS is here to help you if you need any help with these sort of activities. There are numerous technology qualification frameworks as well that are in existence. The most commonly used is DNV RPA203. These outline structured approaches to help mature your technology up the TRL ladder if you need that bit of guidance. You can also identify capture risks under a risk register or an FMEA, put mitigations in place by design where possible to eliminate or reduce these risks. I'll always follow regulations and laws, including your contractual obligations, as we discussed. And as we also mentioned, it's important to follow standards where appropriate or contractually obliged to do so. Ignoring standards introduces risks, but remember, there's not a standard for everything. And this is particularly true if you're developing something new and novel. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. I think we have some time for some questions.
We've had a question coming through just on your last points there while you were discussing TRL. We've had one through from Papa Rao saying, suppose if I want to replace a steel component with an aluminium component in automobile sector, mm-hmm. For example, a yoke component, please give us a brief TRL, TRL 1 to TRL 9. So I suppose what would the TRL progression for that be if you were looking to replace the material of the component?
So let's go. So if you're looking to change the material, it really depends. As if the materials are stipulated at a requirements level, then you could be going back to a TRL 2. But if it's an existing product, really you'd be looking very specifically at what that change of material is. So thinking of it only impacting it briefly, if TRL 2, I'd set the requirements, I'd go into a TRL 3. So I'd look at what would need to happen to the actual physicality of it. Do I need to change the geometry to make it suitable for this change in material? I'd also then go on to a TRL 4 with that change of geometry and then do the calculation work and what have you that we'd be looking at. And then depending on what's going on, we would probably start looking at testing that component. So you may end up doing some specific testing in TRL 5 and TRL 6 to see how it operates. With it being aluminium, there might not be too much concerns regarding environment, but again, you would need to look to see what the industry standards and your own standards would say regarding that. And then TRL 7 and 8 would be going into the prototypes of building up the whole system, or the whole car in this case, or vehicle, with that altered aluminium component.
Brilliant. Cheers, Graham.
Yeah.
If anyone else has any questions, please do feel free to pop them in the chat or in the Q&A function and we'll get them answered. I suppose one thing that I picked up on based on your presentation, Graham, is what are some of the most commonly overlooked considerations that you've seen in your experience when people are assessing product risk or their product development risk?
That's a good question. In terms of risk, a lot of the time it comes down to people not necessarily appreciating outwith of their specific bubble. So generally it's the biggest one would be manufacturing. It's often overlooked. People don't generally consider the manufacturing, or they're from a design or more paper-based background. So it's easy to produce a CAD model, or nowadays also a 3D printed part. But when you come to actually produce that with a manufacturing method, it can introduce all sorts of issues. So unless you've considered that or involved the right people and the right stakeholders at the outset, it's potentially a big issue for you.
Brilliant, cheers. If anyone else has any questions, please do get in touch. Suppose if we do just picking up on that last slide again that you were talking about, it's you were saying that you don't always have to have an applicable standard. There is a, you know, you can innovate out with a standard, but what would be the kind of approach to doing that in terms of making sure that you're still being diligent?
Normally there'll be something that's applicable within a standard. So there may be something tangentially which you could find, which would give you a good basis to build upon. So for instance, I once worked on a flange design, which was pushing beyond the standard design requirements for API flanges. In that instance, what we done was looked at what the work that had been conducted and then looked to expand upon that. So we added additional requirements onto that standard that resolved some of the risks that we had. So that one was specifically high pressure, high temperature. So we had various meetings to discuss and used FMEICAs and FMEAs to essentially sit down and figure out what that introduced in terms of potential product failure and how verification and validation could be used to then resolve that. So what additional analysis did we need? And then what additional testing did we need?
See, cheers. We've had a couple more questions come in there. We've got one from Gavin Kennedy saying, what was behind choosing the PU model? Did you consider other models, for example, lean product and process development or knowledge-based systems?
The decision for the PU model, a lot of the people within the team are actually alumni from DMEM. So it's the one that we're probably most familiar with. Other ones were looked at, but just because of team's familiarity and our use of this one, it became a bit easier for us to jump straight into.
Cool. And we've got one from Andy Loudon saying, I assume this is on your graph slide, the risk versus TRL. The graph is good to articulate the principles. Is this ever calculated or used? The insurance industry and construction clients also use a terminology risk appetite.
That's something interesting. It's not something I've ever been involved in trying to put sort of numbers against the risks. It's certainly something interesting, but not something I've been involved in.
And we've got another saying, suppose some standard values vary country-wise, then what should you do? So if there's a variety across geographical standards.
Sorry, can you repeat that one, Anna?
It says, so suppose some standard values vary country-wise, then what should you do? So.
Okay. So the good example there would be the one I was talking about with the water industry, where we had a product that we'd essentially designed around European codes, mm-hmm. but then later took to the American market and then had to apply the NSF codes to as well. The best thing to do is understand what markets you want to target now and then what markets you want to target in the future. If you look at the markets you want to target now, these are the ones you must do, but it's good to have an appreciation and understanding of potential future markets so you can look at what the impact of those standards would be. In the example I gave, we ended up with essentially an additional product range because we hadn't looked at the American market and what the standards dictated for it. So essentially, if a country has more than one, if you're targeting multiple countries and they have multiple standards, you have to comply with all the standards from all the countries you're looking to target.
Right, so you really need that knowledge kind of upfront before you start your conceptualization piece.
It helps. It certainly helps and prevents rework.
Yeah. Okay, we've got another question then saying, can you comment on likelihood? So whether an innovator or SME would be more likely to bring a product to market if they use this design methodology? And as a follow-up, how many innovators or SMEs have this knowledge when starting out?
Okay, so yes, I think this is probably a very robust way of bringing your product to market. The key part is, if you're bringing a new product to a marketplace, how do you ensure that your customer has faith that the product does what it should do and meets their requirements and needs? So again, it comes back to requirements, but if you can demonstrate it or it involves key third parties that you can then not only point to and discuss with customers, but it then becomes potentially a marketing resource for you that you can then say, well, we have tested this under Lloyd's or another. So this can certainly bolster the credibility of your product. In terms of SMEs and their familiarity with this, it depends on what environment they're coming from. This is the terms TRL and this sort of thing all gets very heavily worked in within grants and these sort of things. Oil and gas and aerospace are also very familiar with them. So if you're looking for funding, it's certainly very powerful. This is where, if you're not familiar with it, really that's where us, the design engineering team, can come in and we can help you guys understand it or give you some guidance. Reach out to Hannah or myself and yeah, we can show you where we think you're at briefly, or we can engage with you to see where we can give you a more meaningful piece of work.
Yep, that, and there's a lot of resources out there at the moment. I know obviously through NMIS and ourselves, and I know that KTN has been doing a lot of work in helping and supporting innovators and SMEs with that kind of thing. So yeah, please do just reach out. We've got another question in saying, should we do all the tests as per the standard when we develop for a prototype component?
Again, as I said, standards aren't a legal requirement, but you have to demonstrate due diligence. So if you essentially had a product failure or, heaven forbid, something catastrophically went wrong, ultimately you as the manufacturer could be held accountable for that and pulled in front of a jury of your peers to essentially sit down and say, how have you demonstrated due diligence? So if you were aware of a standard and skipped something that would have potentially been tested and it's failed based on that, then it's going to be very hard to convince people that you haven't been negligent.
Not to scare anyone.
No, sorry. Yeah, never ask an engineer a doom and gloom question.
So say an innovator was literally just starting out at this point, they've just got a kind of a bright idea. You mentioned there's some sites that you can go on to search and filter through standards and things, but what is kind of the first step in identifying what even category you should be looking for in terms of, is there going to be a standard that's gonna my product will need to align with, or any regulations that I'm going to have to adhere to?
I think the ICS code thing is quite a useful tool for essentially drilling down and getting a smaller list. There's so many standards out there. But I think first and foremost, you probably want to identify where you want to sell your product, identify your market, because you want to be then focusing in on those countries and the standards that they have. If you're not looking to sell to North America now or potentially in the future, then don't go looking for American standards. They're not going to necessarily help you right now. Look primarily at ones for markets you're looking at. It's not to say that you might not consider them. If you don't find anything in a national standard, then you may think that, yeah, let's have a look and see if there's an applicable American standard that might give me some guidance that would assist with my design.
Yeah, that's fair. If anyone else has any questions, I think we'll just take one or two more and then we can all wrap up for lunch and go and get a break. And as we've been saying in the chat, please do feel free, if you've got any follow-up questions or if you want to discuss anything further, you can contact NMIS directly through the nmis-inquiries@strath.ac link that's on the screen at the moment, or please do feel free to get in touch with me directly or Graham to discuss design engineering team. Mine's is h.leslie@strath.ac.uk. Graham's is graham.bisland.
Yeah,
so please do feel free to reach out. Right, if we've got no further questions, I think we will just wrap up there. But as I say, thank you all so much for coming this morning and for some good questions. And please do feel free to get in touch. As I say, I'll pass over to Laura to just wrap things up.
Thanks very much, Hannah. Thank you, Hannah and Graham, for your very informative webinar today. I'll just let the comments run for a few seconds as everybody signs out. And just to let you know that there will be another webinar next week, and it's on Thursday, the 10th of September. The title is Forging Ahead with the AFRC at ENMIS, an introduction to forging and incremental forming technologies. So please do tune into that if it will be of interest to yourself or your company. And we're going to send a survey out shortly, and we'd also be very grateful for your feedback on that. And finally, just to say, a recording of this webinar will be available on our ENMIS YouTube channel shortly. Okay, thanks very much, everybody. And I'm just going to close out the webinar here.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.